Was it just me, or did morning seem to come a little early this morning? Thank God for my wife. She set the alarm clock the right way. Otherwise, I'd still be in bed. Father would have been very surprised and not so happy. Many different types of decisions occupy the moments of our daily lives. There are what we might call life-changing decisions, such as those to get married, make a major purchase, have children, go to college, move. Then there are what we might call major decisions that may not be life-altering, but do affect the outcome of our day, such as the decision to get out of bed, to go bathe, to go to work or school, eat, things like that. And then there are decisions that are very, very minor that we may not even take notice that we're making them. So in today's gospel, the scribes and Pharisees are trying to trap Jesus with a decision that would jeopardize him either way. Jesus' dilemma can be stated this way. If he absolves the woman caught in adultery, it will be said that he has transgressed the precepts of the Mosaic law. If he condemns her, then it might be said that he's going against his compassion and mercy toward sinners. Now, while the accusers are interrogating him, Jesus does something very interesting. He bends down and starts writing with his finger on the ground. So I began to think to myself, what is he writing? Is he bored? Maybe he's writing down the sins of the crowd. Maybe he's writing down the names in the crowd of those who have committed this same sin. Or maybe he's writing down the name of the man involved, because after all, the crowd just brought forth the woman, not the man. Who knows? But then he stands up and he says this, "Let he who is without sin cast the first stone." A very authoritative statement. And it reminds us of this very important point, that only the Lord is the one who can judge. Only the Lord. And it reveals the true meaning of divine mercy, which always leaves open the possibility of repentance and emphasizes the great respect that our Lord has for the dignity of the person, which not even sin can take away. Saint Pope John Paul II observed that this parable teaches us then a lesson about sin and the sinner. Christian forgiveness is not synonymous with mere tolerance, but implies something much more demanding and specific. Christian forgiveness does not mean overlooking evil, or even worse, denying it. The difference here is such. While man tends to identify the sinner with his sin, God does not forgive the evil, but he does forgive the sinner. Jesus teaches us to distinguish the evil act which has just been committed and must be condemned from the person who has committed that act, to whom Jesus offers mercy and the possibility of change, the possibility of taking a different path. Go and sin no more. A different path. And we can apply this principle in our own lives. What this tells us is essentially whatever condition we find ourselves in, we can always open ourselves to conversion, and we can always count on God's forgiveness. As he said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and do not sin again." No matter what, we are always good enough for God's forgiveness. No matter what. That's a great thing. Pope Francis said it this way. He said, "God is the merciful Father who in Jesus loves us beyond all measure and always awaits our conversion at any time. Every time we go wrong, he awaits our return. Those times when we turn away from him, thinking, 'I can do this without him. I got this one. No worries.'" Our Holy Father, Pope Francis, describes the way God works with us this way. Pope Francis says, "He lets us be free, even to make mistakes, because in creating us, he gave us the great gift of freedom. It is for us to put this gift to use. The gift of freedom," Pope Francis says, "always amazes me." So you see, just as in the first reading, where God created paths for the Israelites out of Egypt and through the desert and throughout salvation history, God creates paths for us through situations in our lives that may appear impossible for us to navigate. And he asks us not to look back. Don't be distracted by what happened in the past, as we hear in Isaiah. "Remember not the events of the past, the things long ago. Consider not, I am doing something new." Likewise, when Paul, speaking of his own journey from when he persecuted Christians to when he now was a great prophet, Paul says this, "Just remember one thing, forgetting what lies behind, but straining forward to what lies ahead." Persistence. Don't worry. If you fall down, get up. Persist forward in the right path. We should not allow the mistakes of the past to prevent us from moving forward. Or, God forbid, think for one second that God does not desire for us a better future. He does. So through those emotional deserts or relationship wastelands that we encounter in our lives, God has a path for us to navigate through these difficult times. As always, he does not force us down one path or another. He offers us his radical gift of freedom to choose. Today's gospel also teaches us another important message, and that is, God formed us for a reason, and it is not to sit in judgment of others. Only the Lord can judge. And as we said, when he judges, he forgives the person. He does not forget about the sin. The sin is not good. The person always remains dignified and good. When we judge others, we are refusing to give God the time to work on the human heart. God's love and mercy are vast. There is always time and room for repentance. We are always free to turn from our old ways and choose the path that he has set for us, a path that the Father opened up for us through his only Son, a path through the blood and water that came from our Savior's side as he hung upon the cross. That's the path, and we are free to choose it. But that path requires of us a couple of things. Love, courage, strength, humility, reconciliation, repentance, and most importantly, relationship. Relationship with God and with one another as the community of Christ. So let us rest in faith and in assurance this morning and every morning that this path may not be easy. When Jesus gave that advice to that woman, go and sin no more, that is not an easy path. That's very hard. I speak from my own experience. But we know that if we follow that path, God will come running out to us and joyfully welcome us home.